chains around us. By your grace we are no longer bound, no longer bound. You call me out from the grave. Awakens us, that mercies are new every morning. I don't know why we look for anything other than Him. And we do it all the time, right? We look for our own identity in so many things other than Him. We look at it in our phones and our Instagram, Facebook. There's even apps. I don't know if you know this. You may have seen your friends do it, but there are apps that will literally put a puppy dog face on your face. We're just putting these masks on, just searching. That's what it is. We're searching for our identity and covering up who we think that we are. But you know what? God calls us His sons and His daughters. How good is that? He calls us His children. And He whispers His grace and His mercy over us, His forgiveness over us. And so we're going to sing this song, Sons and Daughters. It's a declaration of who we are, who He says that we are. And so let's remember that promise as we sing this.
Heart is good, He's always kind, with a cross. us children of. Oh, that's crazy. That's crazy. And in His love and kindness, He chose the lowly and the weak. Oh, and we believe His heart is good. He's always high with the cross He broke. He's on our side. Oh, we are the sons, we are the daughters of God. No matter where we go, we're close to the Father's heart. And though we stumble,
how high the mountain I could not climb. desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. And through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Yeah. We'll rejoice in who He is. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such bounty? We're singing for you, Jesus. Thank you.
we sing that you have broken every chain, that in your presence there's fullness of joy, the peace we need, everything we need is found here. God, our lives make sense, our lives are made whole here in your presence. And God, we thank you that you're here, that you're a God that's not far, but you're close. God, that you're near to the brokenhearted. And God, that you want to free us. And that's why we sing of this living hope today. We have confidence in you and in who you are. It's by your spirit and by your strength. And it's in your name we pray. Amen. Wow. Wow. It's a very spiritual word. Wow. You can go and have a seat. Man, y'all were singing. You almost had me convinced for a minute. You were singing good. Well, listen, we're so glad that you're here today. If we haven't met, my name is Drew. I get to serve here as a creative arts pastor. And if you're new with us, if you're first time, we just want you to feel at home. We want you to feel welcome today. We've got a place in the lobby you can stop by. It says new here. You can get a gift. And we just want to hear a little bit more of your story. If you happen to be here for the CMA Fest, we're also glad that you're here. You stand out, by the way, because you're the one like bright red and half asleep. But anyways, we're still glad that you came here today. We're so glad you're visiting with us, and it's just our honor to host you here today. I'm actually going to be singing some Bro Country in the lobby after service, so stand by for that. No, it's not happening. Anyways, we are super glad you're here. And also for us, church doesn't have to just happen on Sunday for us. It's not just about what happened in the walls of our auditoriums. It happens all week long. And so we just want to encourage you, especially as you're traveling this summer and on vacation, just to stay connected with us through social media. You can actually pull out your phone now and kind of stay up to date there, crosspoint.tv and Facebook and Twitter and Instagram and all that stuff. And just super happy to keep the conversation going all through the week. I'm going to invite our greeters to come as we continue to worship through our giving. For us, this is a part of our worship. And so for most of you, you actually give and you partner with us online. So we started this new thing last week. There's a card in the bucket as it passed by. If you're one of those that partner with us financially online, we'd love for you just to take one of these cards. It's not just a thank you. There's also a scripture on here, and it gives a little bit of what we get to do together, how we partner together, but just so a way that you can engage this sacred moment as well. As you're giving, that this can be an act of worship for you as you're giving online. I just want to say thank you. Whether you're giving in the buckets as they're coming by or online, we're just grateful for your partnership. And so Pastor Kevin's coming today. We're going to conclude our series, Five Star Life. Before he comes back, I just want to remind you, next week is Father's Day, and it's going to be a great celebration here. We're actually going to fill the room with like 40 big green eggs, and we're going to have like stations where there's power tools with YouTube videos of how to use them, and just like all... Actually, I can't back that up. I don't think we're doing any of that. But I will say we're going to have a great time. And if you're a dad, you can drag your dad here. You can drag your husband here. If you're a dad, bring your family back and just know this. Next week, you're going to be honored. You're going to be encouraged, and you're going to be respected next week. And so we're excited just to have a great Father's Day celebration. But for today, we're wrapping up this series where Pastor Kevin's been teaching us really about how we posture our heart and how we steward what God has given us. And so with that said, go ahead and get your program out. Take some notes today and lean in as we finish up Five Star Life.
Welcome to Cross Point and our final week of Five Star Life. Now, before we jump in, I just wanted to, I want to call a timeout, and I want us to take a moment and to pray for Big Gross Adventure, for what's going on this week. As across all the campuses, we're going to have hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of kids come through the doors, and hundreds of volunteers will be serving. And it really is. It is a privilege for us to, Jesus said one time to his disciples, he's like, no, let the children come to me. And he said that the kingdom is demonstrated in the way that we love and that we serve children. And it is a privilege for us to be able to open up the doors and have an opportunity for kids to hear the truth of Jesus and for us to give them an amazing experience here. So I want to pray for that. I don't want to just take it for granted. I want us to pray for that together. So can we do that, church? Father, we thank you for what you're doing in our church. We thank you for what you're doing in our hearts. Lord, we thank you for what you're doing in the next generation here. And God, we are grateful for the move of your spirit. And God, thank you that there will be children that will walk through the doors of our church who haven't been through the doors of a church before, and they don't know. Maybe they've never heard the truth of who you are and how you love them. So God, we pray that you give them an incredible joy-filled week. We pray that each night that they're here, God, that they would experience your love and your truth and your presence. And then God, we pray that you would help change their lives, that you'd help change their families. And God, that through Big Gross Adventure, Lord, that you would move in a powerful way. And God, thank you for those who are serving and who will be volunteering. Lord, we pray that they would know your peace and your presence as well. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. We're excited about this week. Excited about today as we finish off our series, finish up the series, Five Star Life, where we're talking about where Jesus said, I have come that you might have life and have it to the full. That's found in John 10:10. What he's saying is, I've come to give you abundant life. I've come to give you full life. I've come to give you life like beyond your imagination. I've come to give you that kind of life that regardless what the circumstances look like around you, you can have the life of God inside of you. That's the kind of life that Jesus came to give us. And we've been using this five-star life as the idea. And I shared with you last week about how my family, how we went on Memorial Day weekend. We went to Chicago, and I told you that we had a five-star experience. And even though we had like a hotel room that smelled like Doritos, we had this five-star experience. But what I did not tell you, and this is just full disclosure, is that we had a no-star moment. Like we had a no-star moment in that five-star trip. And it's a story that... It takes us to a moment that was probably one of the scariest moments I've ever had as a parent. And for my wife and I, it's one of the top five scariest moments we've had as a parent. And it'll be a story that my children will tell their children and probably their children's children. You want to hear it? You don't want to hear it? Okay, I'll tell it to you. So it goes back to the last night we were in Chicago. And so we were like, man, we were jonesing for some sweet tea. But Chicago hasn't fully embraced the gospel of sweet tea yet. And so we're looking around, we're trying to get sweet tea. And so we know that we saw an outpost of heaven called Chick-fil-A. And so we knew if we went to the Christian Chicken, like we knew that they would have sweet tea. And so we went in and like we did at 9:00 p.m. as kind of a nightcap where we're talking about, you know, all the touristy things and all the fun things we did as a family. And so we're sitting around the table, and as we're sitting there, we see commotion out, and we're like right off Chicago Avenue. We're close to the Magnificent Mile. We're close to the hotel where we were staying. And so we're sitting there and we're just, you know, having conversation, doing the recap. And then we see some commotion. We see a crowd kind of run in front of the Chick-fil-A, and then we see the crowd run in the other direction with police officers and police cars and a paddy wagon going behind them. And we thought, wow, this is, you know, entertainment. And you might think, well, you guys felt like maybe a little unsafe, but we didn't, because we knew that God deploys special forces angels to watch over Chick-fil-A's. And so we knew, we were like, we're in a safe place. And also because there was a security guard at the front door. And so like we just knew, okay, we feel safe. But then we're like, okay, at some point we have to get up and leave. And so we thought, well, we give enough time and things have kind of passed. And so we walked to the front and I asked the security guard, I said, hey, are we good to go out now? And he said, yeah, you're good. Just be careful. And so, okay, I'll be careful. So I'm walking out with my family, my wife, four kids. And we walk out in front and we're about to cross over Chicago Avenue. And we're crossing over, and we can kind of see, like, some commotion. We can see a big crowd. And then we hear, bam, 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 like gunshots. And inside your brain, there's something called the amygdala. And it's a little walnut-sized gland that, in a moment when there's perceived threat, it gets hijacked with juice. Like, in that moment, I think that's the official medical term. But it gets hijacked with juice. And in that moment, like, you have one of three options. Do you know what they are? Fight, flight, or freeze. Now, it just happened that in that moment when we heard those noises and we knew, it registered what those were, we knew, we all did the same thing. I mean, it's like, you don't know what you're gonna choose, but in those moments, we took off. And so the Queen family of six is running. My daughters are just taking off, and they're way ahead. They could have won state and track. I mean, in that moment, they're spreading. I'm running next to Bolton, my son, and he's running next to me. Ree and Durham are behind us. They're running too. I look back to make sure they're okay. I see some people from the crowd kind of following after. I don't know if they're chasing us. I ran faster. You might think the real, you know, godly, manly thing to do would be to get behind your wife. Nope, we're going. We are running. I'm taking off. And we get this little side street. Somebody asked us, what are you guys running? And said, there were shots fired. He takes off. And so we're all running. We get around. You know, we finally get to a place where it settled down. You know, you get around other people, I have no idea what just happened. And we're just kind of, And then we're kind of walking really fast. We're not running more. We're just walking really fast to like, we get to the hotel room. We get in the hotel room. I don't know what to do as a dad in this mall. I've never been. But I was like, okay, we should probably like do a debrief. You know, we should probably talk about it. So we get in the room. We shut the door. Durham, you know, my 11-year-old goes and he deadbolts the door just to be safe. And so we go and we sit down on the beds. And I say, okay, guys, I want you all to share your version of the story. And so everybody goes around and shares their version of the story. We go around and listen to everybody share their version. And here's the common denominator in all of our stories. Common denominator was everybody felt fear. The feeling that everybody felt in that moment was fear. Now, fear is a natural and normal response to a perceived threat. So if you want to know what fear is, it's a natural and normal response to a perceived threat. And it's natural to feel fear. The only person who would not have felt fear in that moment is Chuck Norris. But most people, when they experience something like that, most people experience some measure of fear. And we all have things that we're afraid of. My wife, Ree, she's afraid of mice. Anybody else afraid of mice? She feels more normal now. Okay, but I was talking with her, and I was like, Ree, I was like, I know you're afraid of mice, but would you be more afraid of gunshots fired, or would you be more afraid of mice chasing you down that street? True story. She said, mice chasing me down the street. That is not a natural and normal response to a perceived threat. But we all have things that we're afraid of. And here's what I noticed about myself. When I feel fear, my instinctual response, I don't think about it, is I just ball my fist. Anybody with me on that? I mean, I go zero to Rocky like that. I mean, I ball my fist up. And I don't know why it happens like that, but like if somebody jumps out and scares me, I'm like this. Like I go like MMA. I'm ready to throw down. And maybe it's because when I was 12, I took Taekwondo yellow belt, but I don't know. I don't know where that comes from. I'm a lover, not a fighter, unless somebody jumps out and scares me. And then I'm like this. And I was like thinking about it, you know what? That's what fear does. It makes us tighten our grip. Makes us clench up. I mean, that's what fear does, and it happens. Yes, it happens when we're afraid, but it's not just in our fists; it's also in our back. Have you noticed that? Or in our shoulders, we tighten up in our chest when we feel fear. And listen, feeling fear is a natural and normal response. Just our bodies weren't designed to stay there. We weren't created to live in it. And when we live with a chronic sense of fear, it affects our bodies, it affects our souls, it affects our minds. We were hardwired to feel fear. We just weren't created to stay there. And the reason is because it keeps us. It keeps us from living the life that God created us for. See, it's not the things that you do when you're afraid. It's the things that you don't do when you're afraid. It's the five-star life that God created you for, that he designed you for, that he built you for, that fear causes us to shrink back. But fear is something that we all struggle with. And so I figured we would just do a little confession time, because confession is good for the soul. How many of you would say, and we'll just do a show of hands, how many of you would say, and if you're watching online, you can raise your hand too, okay? How many of you would say, I have at some point in my life had a fear of the dark? All right. How many would say, I have had a fear of falling? I have a fear of falling. How many would say, I have a fear of lobsters? Okay, one or two. Okay, how many would say, of those who just raised your hand, how many would say, have had a fear of falling in the dark on lobsters? How many would say, like, that sounds like a bad day? Okay. How many of you have ever been afraid of losing a job? Ever in your life? How many have been afraid of aging? Fears of aging. What about fears related to money? Have you ever been afraid that you would be turned down when applying for a job? How many of you who have children have been afraid that something would happen to your kids? How many have been afraid of the decisions that they would make? How many of you have been afraid that they would grow up and leave home? How many of you have ever been afraid that your children would grow up and not leave home? Okay, right. How many are afraid of being alone? Yeah. How many are afraid afraid of looking foolish? Okay. What about being afraid of failure? Anybody been afraid of success? Yeah. It's a real thing. Afraid of inadequacy? Afraid of rejection? What about afraid of of taking on a task that's too big for you? What about afraid of disappointing others? Have you ever had a fear of disappointing God? Yeah. Did you ever have a fear when I was asking those questions and you were too afraid to raise your hand? Okay, right? We all have fear. And you know what's interesting is that when you read through Scripture, do you know what the most frequent command is? It's not don't lie. It's not be good. It's not be holy. It's not don't commit adultery. It's not honor your mother and father. The most frequent command in all of Scripture is don't be afraid. Don't fear. Now, feeling fear is human. It's part of being human. But it's living in fear that keeps us from being fully human. It's living in fear that keeps us from living the life that God created us for. And it's not the things that you do when you're afraid. It's the things that you don't do. See, when we make fear our zip code, when we live there, we miss out on the life that God created us for, what he called us to. We miss out on the five-star life. So what I want us to do is I want us to look at some scripture together from Luke chapter 12. Now, this is the passage that we've been reading through as we've been working through this series. And if you've got a Bible, you can turn to Luke chapter 12, verse 32. If you don't have a Bible, there are scriptures in your program. We will actually have it up on the screen for you to follow along. If you're on a mobile device, Luke chapter 12, verse 32. And just to remind you, in this context, what's going on, Jesus has just taught a crowd of thousands upon thousands of people. But right here, he's pulled the conversation into his disciples, into his closest 12. He pulls them around and he huddles them up for a conversation of just Jesus and those who are his followers. Not just the ones who are curious, but for the ones who are his followers. Jesus pulls them in and he has a conversation, he has dialogue with them. Luke chapter 12, verse 32. He says, "Don't be afraid, little flock, for your Father has been pleased to give you the kingdom. Sell your possessions and give to the poor. Provide purses for yourself that will not wear out, a treasure in heaven that will never fail, where no thief comes near and no moth destroys. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." So what Jesus is saying, hey, guys, come here. He calls them in close and he's like, listen. He's like, don't be afraid. Hey, you don't have to be afraid. Don't be afraid because you're my flock, little flock. Like, you belong to me. So Jesus is saying, he's calling me, he says, you belong to me and you need to know that you have a heavenly Father who cares for you. You have a heavenly Father who loves you. You have a heavenly Father who delights in, who takes good pleasure in giving you the kingdom. And so you don't have to run around with an orphan spirit. You don't have to run around with a spirit of fear. You can just rest and know that your Father sees you and that he cares for you. You have a Father in heaven. Don't live like you don't have a Father who cares for you. You don't have to be afraid. To those who are fearful, Jesus says, you have a Father who cares for you, and it brings him good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Now, what is the kingdom? How do we get it? Here's the kingdom. This represents the kingdom of God. What is the kingdom of God? It's his rule and his reign. It's his power and his presence. It's his dominion. It's his governance. It's his authority. It's his character. It's his nature. It's where what God says goes. It's his power and God's kingdom. Jesus came with the good news message that the kingdom of God is now here, that the kingdom of God is not just up there, but it's now here, and it's available for anyone and everyone to get in on this kingdom. So God has a kingdom, but guess who else has a kingdom? You have a kingdom. So just like God has a kingdom, you have a kingdom, and your kingdom is your range of your effective will. It's where you have choices. It's where you have power. It's where you have dominion. It's where you rule. And so you have a kingdom, and your kingdom has boundaries. I mean, your boundaries of your kingdom, that's your bedroom, and that's your office, and that's your cube, and that's your house. Your house is part of your kingdom. Unless you're married, then your house is her kingdom and you just get to stay there. And then your car is part of your kingdom. Your phone, your things, your stuff, your bank account, your retirement. Like, it's all part of your kingdom. Your time, your talent, your treasure, it's part of your kingdom. And we make decisions every day in our kingdom. We get to make choices that are part of our kingdom because that's where we have authority and that's where we have rule and we have reign. You have boundaries of your kingdom. On both sides of you, on the seat that you're sitting in, there is a line on one side, there's a line on the other. Those are boundaries. If you cross that boundary, you're in somebody else's kingdom. That's why we sit, like, in the seat. That's why when we talk to people, we have personal space. That's why when a close talker comes in, that's a kingdom infraction. They have crossed over into your kingdom. If you don't know what a close talker is, you probably are one. And so there's just, when somebody cuts you off in traffic, like that's a kingdom. There are boundaries and that's your kingdom in conflict with another kingdom. And so we all, and when we feel fear, listen, when we feel fear in our life, it's because we feel like our kingdom's being encroached upon. Or we feel like our kingdom is out of control. Or we feel afraid of what other people will think about how we're ruling and reigning in our kingdom. Or we get fearful that somebody's trying to take something from our kingdom. Or we feel afraid that somebody has encroached upon our boundaries and our territory. And when our kingdom feels threatened, that's when we feel fear. And Jesus' disciples came to him and they were like, Jesus, teach us how to pray. And he knew the disciples struggled with fear. And look at what he says. He says, when you pray, I want you to pray like this. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So what Jesus is saying is when you pray, pray, God, would your kingdom come to my kingdom? See, because we can't have his kingdom and our kingdom at the same time. We have to surrender our little kingdom. That's what to be a follower of Jesus means. It means we take our little kingdom and we give it to him. And so now we bring our kingdom inside his kingdom. We bring all our stuff, my family, my relationships, my resources, bring all our stuff, my job, my pressures, my fears, my failures, my successes. I'm bringing everything I am and I'm saying, God, my kingdom, it belongs to you. I'm giving it to you. I'm loosening the grip on my kingdom because when we get afraid and we want control, we tighten our grip. And what Jesus is teaching us is the way of life is to open up our grip and say, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Up there, come down here. See, the gospel is not just about you getting from down here to up there when you die. The gospel is getting up there, down here, so that you can truly live. And how do you get up there, down here? You say, open hands, God, I surrender my kingdom. And Jesus showed us what it was like to live life with open hands. When everybody was running around like this, Jesus lived life like this. And he loved freely, and he taught freely, and he ministered healing, and he ministered healing. I made that up. But he ministered people by healing with open hands. And think about it, the moment that it came to lay down his life, he said, Father, not my will, but yours be done. I surrender my kingdom to you. And on the cross, he didn't clench his fist and shake his fist at those who were crucifying him. He laid his life down in obedience. He laid his life down for you. He laid his life down for me. And he opened up his hands. And he willingly went to the cross. And he said, into your hands I commit my spirit. And he breathed his last and then he died. But that wasn't the end. There's a resurrection. And if we want to experience the resurrection, the freedom of the resurrection in life, it requires the open-handed living of saying, God, I open up my hands. I give it to you. But the natural response is to clench your hands. But when we clench our hands, we miss out. Because if we live open-handedly, ultimately, we're going to take a step of faith. And see, where fear robs us is it keeps us from doing the thing that God has called us to do. It's the job that we never apply for. It's the ministry that we never jump into. It's the date that we never ask for. If you're sitting next to somebody and they just said amen at that point, you may want to consider if you came here with them, maybe the amen was for you. But it's the date that we never ask for. It's the phone call that we never make. It's the hard conversation that we never have. It's the friendship that we never begin. It's the book that we never write. It's the business that we never start. It's the marriage that we never propose for. Fear causes us to shrink back, the fear of what ifs. But faith is open-handed saying, God, I'm going to take the step that you want me to take. And I'm going to do it in faith, believing in you. And Jesus said, don't be afraid. Let me just ask you this. What's the step of faith that fear is costing you? What's the thing that God's put in your heart to do? But that fear is causing you to hold back and God's saying, will you step out in faith? Listen, I'll go back to Chicago. That wasn't the last time I'm going to Chicago. Now, if my wife sees mice, it might be the last time she goes to Chicago, but it's not the last time we're going to Chicago. I'm not going to let fear keep me from going back there. But listen, where's the place that fear is keeping you from going? And the open hand of you're saying, "Now I'm gonna step out in faith." And Jesus said, "Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid, not because you're so great, but because your Father is. Because you have a Father in heaven who is he's the perfection of everything you longed for in a daddy. And he loves you, and he is with you, and he's attentive for you, and he sees you, and he provides for you, and he protects you, and he's gone before you, and he fights for you. And it's impossible for you to unson yourself or undaughter yourself from him. He will never leave you nor forsake you. And when you know how good your Father is, that's where you find your faith, and that's where you find the courage to take the next step. Because his kingdom is eternal. It never ends. Now, it's right now, but it's also forever. It's here and now, but it's also hereafter. And so the reason we can have courage and the reason we don't have to fear is because death is not the worst thing that can happen to you. Hell is the worst thing that can happen. And in Christ, he's already taken care of that. And so when you've given your heart to Christ, you live forever. But Jesus didn't give his life on the cross just so you could live forever. It's also that you could live abundant life now. And he said, will you pray, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven in me. And when we feel fear, that's when we tighten our grip. But when we open up our hands, that's when we receive his peace. Reminds me of what happened with Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. It was during the time of the Montgomery bus boycotts, and things had become perilous for him. The threats were rolling in, and one night, it was past midnight, and he was sitting at his table in his home. His wife and his daughter were in bed. And as he sat there, phone call came in. And the man on the line said, "Martin, if you don't stop preaching what you're preaching, we're going to take your life and kill your wife and your baby daughter." He said after he hung up the phone, he sat there at the table, and he was frightened. He was afraid. He said with his head hung over a cup of coffee, he began to weep. And he said, "God, I can't do it. I'm too weak, too tired. I can't carry on." And then out of the silence, he said, "It seemed that in that moment I could hear an inner voice saying to me, 'Martin Luther, stand up for righteousness, stand up for justice, stand up for truth, and I will be with you. Even until the end of the world, you are not alone.'" Dr. King said that was the most important night in his life. He said from that moment, he drew strength when other problems came. And it's his presence that gives us peace. I just want to call a time out in the message, and I want to pray. Because it seems that there may be some who are in here, and you feel that grip on your heart and fear. And I want to pray for God's peace for you. So can we just bow our heads and our hearts? I want to invite you, if you're struggling with fear right now in an area of your life, just to grip your hands as a symbol of the fear that you feel in your heart. And so, Father, I pray for those who would be honest in their confession with you that fear has a chokehold on their hearts. And, Father, you are the perfect Father in heaven. And you sent your son Jesus because they were worth it. And you have poured out your spirit to give them power and to give them peace. And you said your spirit would be their comforter. And so right now, that's your prayer. Would you just open up your hands? Father, I pray that as they open their hands and open their hearts, that you would pour out your peace. I pray that you would pour out your love, and God, that they would sense your presence, and that up there would come down here, that your presence and power, your rule and your reign would break off anywhere a spirit of fear has taken hold in their hearts. And God, that they would know your spirit of peace and of love, and their confidence would be rooted in you and who they are in you and to you. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Now, I want us to jump back in. And some of you are like, that felt like what you do at the end of the message. I'm just going to fake you out just real quick. Just juke you out and bring you back to the text for a couple more minutes. In verse 33, Jesus said, "Sell your possessions and give to the poor. Provide purses for yourselves that will not wear out, a treasure in heaven that will never fail, where no thief comes near and no moth destroys. Jesus says, don't let fear dictate your relationship with your stuff. And that happens. You ever seen the show Hoarders? In that show, I mean, I think that's one of the most real and raw reality shows. And all, but on A&E, and going to people's houses where for years, sometimes decades, sometimes a lifetime of piling up stuff and living among the piles. And some people are stuck in the midst, or maybe stuck in the past, maybe because of pain, shame, guilt, regret, fear. That's what happens. Fear tightens a grip on our stuff. And most of us are more sophisticated. Many of us are more sophisticated than those we see with our gripping than those we see on Hoarders. But still, in places when we feel afraid, we tighten our grip. We tighten our grip on stuff. And what Jesus is calling us to is he's saying, hey, would you let me walk in the mess? Would you let me walk through the mess with you? And would you let me reveal the kind of things that are holding you back? So maybe we can have a garage sale. Maybe we can put some stuff on eBay. Maybe we can get Craigslist and we can get some stuff that's holding you back, and we can sell it, and we can take that money and we can give it to the poor. What Jesus is saying is, he's saying, I want to free you up for more. And he says, and when you give to the poor, when you invest in the things that last forever, what lasts forever, God and people, when you invest your resources in what lasts forever, he says, there is a heavenly ROI. He said, there's a return on investment that lasts forever. But when we live open-handedly, what happens is people see through us, they see that our Father is a giver. They see the generosity. They see who our dad is and what our dad's like. I told you last week that my earthly father is one of the most generous men that I know. When I became a pastor, he came to me, and this was a long time ago. He came to me and he said, Kevin, I said, I want to give you this. And he gave me an envelope, and on the front of the envelope, it said blessing cash. And I opened it up, and there were hundreds of dollars inside that envelope. And he said, I want to give this to you because now that you're a pastor, there are going to be circumstances, there are going to be people, there are going to be situations that you're going to encounter as a pastor that I don't encounter in my business. And so I want you to be able to bless them. Just bless them from me. You don't have to tell them it's from me. You don't have to tell them anything. Just bless them. And I was like, this is awesome. Like, to be able to go around with some blessing cash and be able to help people. And so it was cool because the radar's up, you know. I'm looking around. I actually put it in my glove box in the car and, locked that thing up. And so I got it in there, and I'm always ready. And so there came a situation, you know, there was a single mom in a situation. I'm like, oh, man, I got that blessing cash. I go to the car, open up, and I would, like, fold it up in my hand. I say, you know what, I've got a friend who gave me some money and said that they would, you know, they wanted me to bless others. I just felt like this is supposed to be for you. And so I give it to them. It was awesome. And then I call my dad. Hey, Dad, you won't believe what I'm doing. I'd tell them the story. And then there were other times, you know, there would be a person broke down on the side of the road and come help them out with the tire. I was like, oh, I got some blessing cash. I go to the blessing cash. I was like a blessing bomber, just going around, just like dropping. Don't ever do that again, Kevin. But it was incredible. And so I'm like, man, this is awesome. I call my dad and I tell him the stories. I mean, it's just, and God would put these opportunities in front of me. And then one day there was this guy who was in need, and he lost his job, and he was in a tough place. And I just, oh man, that's awesome. Blessing cash. I go to the car and open up the envelope, and I look in. There's no cash in there. Like, I've used it all. And then it was like, I felt like, it's almost like God said, well, what are you going to do now, big boy? I mean, God doesn't call me big boy, but if he did, I was like, oh, you're going to give from y'all? And here's what I learned from that. It's easier to be generous with my father's money than it is mine. But you know what God taught me through that? Is that everything I have belongs to my Father in heaven. That everything we have belongs to him. And through the way that we're generous, people see we look like our daddy. And we look like our Father in heaven, who's a giver. And so it's saying, God, would you bring me the realization that everything I have belongs to you? And God, would you help my radar be up so that I would be able to bless other people? Not so that they could see how great I am, but so that they could see how great you are. And that's why Jesus said, when you bless other people, do it in secret. Because if you do it for the reward, you just got your reward. But your reward is in heaven when you do it in secret. And this is, this thing of living generously is what he calls us to. But really what I figured out is that when I shrink back and tighten my grip, it's because of fear. because I'm afraid that there won't be enough for me. And I'm afraid that I won't be able to provide for my family. And I'm afraid that that person might come back. I'm afraid that if I give to that person and there's another person that hears that I gave to that person, they might come to me and want me to give to them. I'm afraid that they might take what I give and use it for something that I'm no longer in control of. Fear can cause me to tighten my grip, but what God's teaching me is, Kevin, will you trust me? Will you seek me to lead you? His kingdom come, his will be done on earth as it is in heaven, that up there would come down here through us. But it takes faith. It takes faith to live like that. And what Jesus is saying is faith is taking the long view. See, fear is nearsighted, but faith takes the long view. Faith looks to the future. And Jesus said, when you give, it's not just in that moment, but it affects life in heaven. That how you invest your life here on earth it affects how we live in heaven. He says, listen, let me just give you a principle in all life. The longer the view you take, the better decisions you make. It's true when you're thinking about that next piece of pizza. Take the long view. That's not any fun, right? It's true when you think about investing. It's true when you think about dating. True? I mean, do you have some past relationships that if you took the long view, it would have been better? The longer the view you take, the better decisions you make. Take the long view. See how he treats his mama. It says a lot about the way a guy treats his mama. Take the long view. The longer the view you take, the better decision you make. And Jesus said, the longer the view you take with your resources, the better decisions you make. Think toward eternity. Because earth is not your home. Now, what if I told you that we went back to the Dorito room and we went back there and, man, the scent was horrible. And I looked at Ree and I said, listen, Ree, I've had it with the Dorito smell. In this room, the decor is not good. Listen, let's go to the bank. Let's get all of our savings. And here's what we did. We took all of our savings and we took them out and we went and we did a complete rehab on that hotel room. And we fixed it up. We got a new bed, new comforter. We bought some antiques, got some artwork. We put it up and we fixed the smell. I mean, the place looked incredible. If we told you that we do that, you'd say you're crazy. I mean, there's no reason that you would take your treasure, that you take your resources and change a hotel room that you're only staying in a short time. And Jesus is saying, don't exhaust everything that you have here in this life. I mean, use stuff and enjoy stuff, but think about eternity. That's why he says this. That's why he says, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Because what you invest in, your heart follows that. What you invest in, your heart follows that. If you own Apple stock, you'll have that little app up on your phone and you'll follow Apple stock. If you invest in Amazon stock, you'll look at that app and listen, when you own a house, you follow the real estate market more closely than when you're renting a house. Because what you invest in, your heart follows that. And when you invest in God and you invest in people, your heart follows that. I want to let you know how grateful we are for your generosity as a church, for what we're able to see God do. It happens through generosity. It happens through giving. And every time you see someone whose life has been changed, you see someone who has stepped into the kingdom, you see someone who's found hope that's only found in Jesus, you see somebody, a marriage that's restored, you see a child find Jesus and find faith. You see a teenager whose life has changed. Every time you see it, it's because of the way that you give. It's the way that you pray. It's the way that you love. It's the way that you serve. It's the way that you invite. And you've played a part of that. But it's also through what happens online. I don't know if you realize it, but every single week, there are thousands of people who are watching online, some who are on the other side of the world. And we're glad that you're with us on the other side of the world. But we're also glad that you're with us on the other side of town. See, there are people who watch online who don't walk through the doors of, maybe never walk through the doors of a church. Maybe it's been a long time, and it's a long time because of shame or because of fear. And we want you to know when you're ready, we'd love to have you. But until then, we're grateful that you're a part of what's going on here through the screen, through behind your computer, behind your mobile device. We're grateful you're a part of this. And I want to say thank you as a church for the way that you're giving to make that possible. And it's because of that generosity that stories like what I'm about to share with you are able to happen. And it's because of because of people like you, that stories like Stephanie's story come into reality. I want you to experience this and enjoy, but at the same time, hear what God has done in her life in a powerful way through you.
My name is Stephanie. I'm from Alabama, very small town. I grew up church every time the doors were open. So it was something that was just implanted in me from, you know, day one. Grew up teenager. Of course, the typical things in school, was always the kid that got picked on. My mom was like, I can remember you just not being a happy child. She said there was nothing any of us could do. I always felt like I wasn't enough. Like something was wrong with me. Wanted to do anything I could to get approval. Want to feel liked or wanted. I actually started working on a church full time. Something was missing. And it's because I took my eyes off of what I needed to be focused on. You know, my heart had changed. I wasn't doing it for the right reasons. And then when you've stepped away from what's filled the biggest hole in your life of all the time, which of course was church and God, you look for anything that'll fill that hole. For me, it was alcohol. And that was just because I was miserable. I didn't want to feel. And it became a problem, and I started abusing it. And I started, you know, every so often I would do cocaine. I forgot what it was like to be happy, and that was a new normal for me, was to be high or to be drunk. Started getting involved with a guy I didn't need to be involved with. Was committing adultery. He was married. And I got pregnant. The only thing I could think of was I have to have an abortion. And I did. I chose to have an abortion, and I didn't know what to do after that. At that point, it got so dark. The worst, I think, breaking point for me when it got the worst was I had a dream about my child. And I remember sitting there and I woke up just screaming, crying. And I knew God was like, I'm here. He's like, I'm here. I didn't care. I rolled out of bed, went over to my fridge, opened up a bottle of wine, kept drinking. Couldn't get back to sleep, so I went to a bar. I don't remember the rest of the night. Somehow, between meeting, you know, people that were involved in music stuff, I found out, I'm actually pretty good at this. But they've encouraged me, you should move to Nashville. And somehow I ended up moving to Nashville. It was in July of 2016. And because I thought, this is it, I get to start over. You can't outrun yourself. Found that out. On Sunday morning, I woke up and I said, all right, just because. I Googled, you know, churches in Nashville. Crosspoint came up. And then it just happened to be the first one I clicked on, and it came up and said, join now. It was the live service. And I thought, well, this is neat. All I saw was this guy that was so emphatic, and he was talking, and he was smiling, and I recognized that joy. I recognized the peace that I saw in this guy. Come to find out, it was Bob Goff. But what was weird is that after that Sunday morning, I didn't drink. Didn't crave it. Didn't want it. So Easter Sunday, I woke up. Next thing I know, I'm pulling up Crosspoint. That morning, you know, I watched the service and everything. I logged on. Then I noticed there's this chat window next to it. And I said, all right, cool. So I typed in my name and started chatting and talked to a girl named Heather on there. I mean, she was precious. Everybody that was on there was so nice. Next Sunday morning, though, I set my alarm. That was the second time in 3 years that I had actively woke up early on a Sunday morning, which was my only off day, to, you know, hear about God. Heather and them said, you know, you're never too far gone. That was the thing. You're never too far gone for a comeback. And I decided, all right, the next Sunday I'm going. You know, I'm going to church. And I was meeting Heather for the first time. It's like as soon as we made eye contact, it was like, I was so genuinely happy to talk to her and get to meet her face to face and just to say thank you. And of course, it was a Mother's Day thing, so of course I'm thinking about my child. For the first time, I'd really felt like a release from it. Like I felt forgiveness for it because I prayed during that service about it. After that, you know, Sundays were it. I loved it. And it wasn't, don't get me wrong, I love Crosspoint. I don't even think it was about just being happy at Crosspoint. No, it was about happy about being in the presence of God. My shame, my guilt, my condemnation, everything was gone. I'm joyful again. My spirit's different. I catch myself being happier. I've had people tell me I can see a difference in you. Now my next step, I definitely is whenever they have the next baptism service, I need to get baptized.
Would you be open to Kevin baptizing you this Sunday as this video closes out?
Ooh. Yeah. I would love that.
So here we have Stephanie, and can we just give a Cross Point welcome and love for Stephanie? Come on, all the campuses. And so Stephanie, all across Middle Tennessee, people are celebrating and rejoicing what God has done in you. And I want to thank you for your courage, and thank you for your faith. Thank you for your vulnerability, being able to share in your story, and knowing that there are other people who your life is making a difference in them. And so thank you for that. And this is a special moment for you. And we want to celebrate this moment. And after Stephanie's baptized, I want to invite the biggest Cross Point celebration that we've ever had across Middle Tennessee. Invite you to jump up to your feet, high five, hug, celebrate together. Because Scripture says that when one person finds the grace of Jesus and returns to the Father, that a party breaks out in heaven, that the angels celebrate and rejoice. And so we're going to pray that up there would come down here through the way that we celebrate and through we rejoice what he's done in you. And so, so Stephanie, I have two questions for you. One, do you trust Jesus for the forgiveness of your sin?
Yes.
And do you commit to follow him all the rest of your life?
Absolutely.
All right. Well, it's upon your profession of faith, it's my privilege to baptize you, my sister in Christ, in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So it is a party today, Stephanie, and we're celebrating what God has done in your heart and what he's done in your life and what he's continuing to do. But thank you for your vulnerability. Thank you for sharing your story with us. She was baptized. Stephanie was baptized at the 9 o'clock service, and we thought we'd just baptize her each service. And that was really, like, no, we won't. And once in the name of the Father, another in the Son, the Holy Spirit. No, we do that. But thank you for that moment. And heaven truly does celebrate. And here's what I know, that Stephanie's story has already begun, and many people stirring some things in them. God's moving their life. And so if you would like prayer, or if you need to take that next step of baptism, or you say, you know what, I've just got some questions about who Jesus is and the work he can do in me, we're going to have some pastors and some leaders that'll be down front, and I would love to talk with you and share with you. But I want to pray, as we've got Stephanie here, I want to pray for you, and then we'll be dismissed. God, I thank you. I thank you for what you do. I thank you that you make all things new. I thank you for your redemption and for your restoration and for your healing and for the wholeness. And I thank you, God, that in Christ we are a new creation, that the old is gone, that the new has come. And so, God, would we carry that inside of us? And I pray that this week that we would live in faith, and that we would take a step in faith, and that fear wouldn't hold us back, and that up there would come down here through us. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You're dismissed. Have a great week.